So what I'm going to ask you guys to do is to keep an open mind, suspend judgment, and have fun. So the basic message that I want to leave with you guys today is that you are a story. And so when people use that maybe terrifying word networking, really what you need to get really good at is telling your story, which is easier said than done. It takes quite a bit of time because it actually requires a lot of self-reflection and interaction with others to kind of test and prove and understand who you are. So this is actually, I found this from a website called Mrs. Lorber's fourth grade website. And I like it because it demonstrates and visualizes the narrative arc of every story. So whether or not you're thinking about telling your story about who you are from the point of birth or from the point of when you got to Vassar or whatever the discrete moments are, there's always a hook. There's always this kind of what's called an exposition. There's usually some sort of a catalyst for a problem or a challenge, doubt, worry, fear, the unknown. There's some sort of rising action. The hero, heroine has some setbacks. Then there's this climactic moment. I think that Mrs. Lorber didn't want to use the word climax for her fourth graders, but typically in the narrative arc, it's called a climax. Then there is resolution. Everything falls into place and it concludes. So that's kind of the basic visual arc of any story. And I'll share these slides with you guys if you're interested in kind of moving on and work. Maybe you guys can even work together in some of this stuff going forward. But this is a really cool framework also for thinking about how to tell story, which is called the 3x3 narrative framework. And this was written, this was developed by someone who was trying to help companies tell their stories. But this also works really well for the individual who's trying to tell their story. And again, there's always this burning question. There's some sort of catalyst for change. Let me go down the vertical axis, the y-axis. The burning questions are who wants what? What is it that you're trying to get out of this weekend? What is it that you're trying to get out of your life? It could be much more existential than this weekend. How are you going to try to get it? Is it going to be an internship? Is it going to be an informational interview? Is it going to be a phone call? And then what would success look like to you? Would it be to have coffee with one person who you met over the weekend by March? Would it be LinkedIn connections, et cetera? And what did you learn? And that links to, you know, you are the character, your actions are in that second row, how you're going to get your networking done, and then you are going to resolve it by, you know, checking something off the list. And here's how it works in a real fairy tale type of way. So this is the story of Cinderella. So here's her situation in three words, and here's the challenge in three words. Cinderella can't go. The action, attends ball anyway. The result, Cinderella gets prince. The point in showing you this is that when you're in these kind of constrained time environments, you have to be able to get your story across in a really condensed, quick amount of time. I'm not going to be asking you to do this today, but I just wanted you to kind of see the different approaches that you can have for storytelling. You guys have heard of IBM, right? It's had a lot. It actually was housed here. Its major headquarters was pretty dominant here up through the 80s and early 90s. IBM was based in Poughkeepsie. It's had a lot of ups and downs. It actually now is a pretty innovative company to the extent that it had a collaboration with MoMA in New York a few years ago and is on this binge to hire designers, over 1,800 designers. So here's what IBM's situation was. IBM nearly disintegrates. Action, the CEO at the time, Gerstner, redefines roots, and the result, integrated solutions succeed. So you might want to play around with what is your situation, just three words, what's the action, and then what's the result. And again, I'll share these slides. So here's the template. You're going to be thinking about the current situation, the action you take, and the result you achieve. This actually maps really nicely to the hands-on activity we're going to be doing. So When I was in grad school, the first time I was in grad school earning my master's degree, the dean of our program circulated this article. This article came out in 1997, and it was published in Fast Company magazine, and it was called The Brand Called You. And I had my hands on my hips, and I was very disgruntled with that, because I thought, I am not a commodity. I'm a person. I'm a human being. And I am not for sale. And then I read this article, and a few months later, I really began to understand the value in starting to understand myself in this way. If at any point you study marketing, there's something called the four P's of marketing. And they are the product, the price, the way a product, service, or experience is promoted, and then how it's distributed or placed. Product, price, promotion, and place, right? And Peter's point, this is Mr. Peters, he's a marketing guru, he said, we are the CEOs of our own company, Me Inc., right? You have a product. You better know what your product is, right? What's your service or experience that you engage people with, right? You have a price that might translate into salary, right? You have a way that you promote yourself, and now you guys have so many awesome platforms to do that. And then you also have a distribution channel, a way that you're going to place yourselves. Fast forward decades later, there's this really cool book that comes out called Business Model U, which I highly recommend you take a look at. It's based on another book called Business Model Generation. It uses a really wonderful visual way for you to diagram who am I, who do I connect with, what's the best way for me to relate to people, what do I give in order to demonstrate my value at the bottom, and what do I get in return? There's financial value that I get in return, as in a salary, a stipend, but there's also a lot of intangible benefits that you can get when you are building your career, when you're doing internships. So I'm showing you I'm ending kind of with this visual diagram because that's really the emphasis of how I think you can retain your story. We're going to be working a part of today with a really cool framework. It's called Start With Why. Have you guys heard of Simon Sinek? He got into trouble recently because he was super critical of, well, you guys aren't millennials, you guys are Gen Z, right? But he was super critical of millennials and he got into some trouble. That aside, I think the guy has some interesting things to say. And he actually didn't think of the golden circle. Like many innovations, it's the way that he applied something that has been in place for quite some time. And here's his point. The most compelling brands, and if we extend Peter's idea that you are a brand, right? The most compelling brands don't start with what they do. They start with their why. Why do you exist? Why did you decide to spend 4 years of your lives investing in this education? Why are you trying to study what you're going to be studying? I guess you're going to be declaring soon, right? Most compelling brands start with their why. They don't start with their what. They then move on to how they get stuff done, and then they end with their what. So let me give you two quick examples. He gives actually a really awesome TED Talk. If we think about the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, his birthday was just celebrated. He did not start with his what when he was trying to galvanize people to march on Washington. If he had said, come on, folks, let's march on Washington, life as it is for African Americans really sucks, people would be like, I don't know, my job's good, things are kind of dangerous out there, I don't think I'm going to take the risk. He started instead with the why. He started with, all Americans are entitled to access to excellent education, housing, and healthcare, and should not be judged on the basis of the color of their skin, right? He said, we need to do something about the inequitable access that currently exists by galvanizing and meeting in our church basements and getting together in our community centers. And what are we going to do? We're going to march on Washington. And people can get behind that. The other example that Simon Sinek gives is Apple. Apple basically sells tracking devices, right, in the form of these smartphones. If Apple started with their what, you'd be like, I don't think so. But they start with their why. Why do we exist? To simplify and delight you in your life. How do we do it? We hire really groovy and cool techies and engineers and designers. And what are we selling? We're selling really awesome tracking devices, smartphones, right? So start with your why. That is the most compelling direction. So before we get to the business of doing, where I want you to discover how you can use these ideas, I want to leave you with a premise, which is that we are hardwired to be visual creatures. And I'll give you an example. When you see that word, apple, there's an image that comes to your mind, right? All of us in this room have a variation of what that image is. For some, if we had only stuck with the text, and if I'd been doing this presentation with just slides full of words, you'd be running out here, tearing out your hair, and understandably. We don't retain and absorb information that's only visual text in the same way that we do with images. So, for example, that's one way of explaining what an apple is. But another way of explaining what an apple is might be this. Maybe that's what came to your mind. Or maybe you were thinking of apples in context, and you're thinking of it in an orchard. Maybe you were thinking of it as a doodle. Perhaps you were thinking of an abstract painting version of an apple. Maybe you were thinking of the cultural context in our society about apples and the Garden of Eden. Maybe you went to the brand apple because the brand apple is so successful in resonating their company whenever we hear that and see that word. Or maybe you were thinking of New York City, the Big Apple. The point is that there are all these wonderful visual interpretations of this one word that are pretty compelling and actually more effective than just a lot of words. So now, to prove my point that we're hardwired as to be visual creatures, do you remember all those images you looked at like 5-10 minutes ago? So we're going to revisit them. But this time, when I show you a slide, there's going to be two images. One is going to be an image that you saw, and one is going to be an image that you haven't seen. So I want us all as a collective in this room to yell out left or right, depending on if it's the image, the visual that you already saw. Ready? Any questions? All right, let's try it. Trick question. You saw them both. Wait, no more trick questions. Neither is the last trick question. Okay. Awesome. Give yourselves a round of applause. So, you guys, by really quickly just having those images cascade over your body, absorb it visually, you remembered 98% of every single one of those images that I showed you. So that's my first point to prove that we are hardwired to be visual creatures. But to prove my point even further, I'd like you to take one of the sheets of blank paper and a Sharpie. Just one piece of paper, save the rest, and a Sharpie. Okie dokie. Everyone have their paper and the Sharpie. Okay. Would you, on your piece of paper, would you draw a dot? A dot. Anywhere, just a dot. Would you please draw a line? You can be big, don't be timid. Would you please draw a circle? Nice. How about a square? Awesome. A triangle? How about a stick person smiling? Stick person smiling. How about a confused looking stick figure person? How would you make them look confused? How about a house? Maybe a rectangle with a triangle on top. Nice. How about a straight line arrow? Bless you. And how about a squiggly line arrow? Nice. And finally, how about a Venn diagram, three intersecting circles? Guess what, everybody? You can draw, okay? So, no one gets to say,
I'm not a creative type, I can't draw, or I don't know how to draw.
You absolutely can draw, right? You have the ability to doodle. Now, this is a visual that comes from one of my colleagues, now friends, Dan Rome. Dan Rome is awesome. Dan Rome studied biology and fine art in college, and he jokingly says, so what did I do? I became a consultant. But that hybrid way that he had of thinking and working actually came in handy quite well for him when he was a consultant at Anderson Consulting. Anderson is now Accenture Consulting. And Dan has written many books. The first of his books was called The Back of the Napkin. He wrote a book called Blah, 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 When Words Aren't Enough. His latest book, which I highly recommend, is called Draw to Win. His point is that if you can visualize an idea, your ability to visualize an idea has less to do with your ability to draw, but it has everything to do for your capacity for complex abstract thinking. Everything. Because if you can describe, that first we started with this situation, we'll call it a circle, then we added in this dynamic, we'll call it a square, that led to equal sign change, a triangle, you begin to engage people in conversation. And you end up guiding the conversation, negotiating the deal, and getting buy-in for your lives later on. Trust me on this. You can start practicing it now. So we're going to take your capacity for visualizing concepts in the following way before we get to that. This is what we're going to be moving on to do. We're going to be clearing away the chairs, but I'm going to ask you to doodle your responses to the following three questions. Who are you? Where do you want to go? And how might you get there? And to find the space to do that, we actually would like you to stand up and stack the chairs, five chairs high at a time, on the wall. And we want you to make yourselves comfortable on the floor, sprawled out, and we'll get started. You have 3 minutes to stack the chairs against the wall. 3 minutes. Are we good? Good and cozy? So we're gonna work on this for about 30 minutes. I'd recommend that you gauge, it's been about 10 minutes per question. Give it some thought. You can chat amongst yourselves if that's helpful too. If you just wanna kinda make this a solitary process, that's cool too. Design thinking is a problem framing and it's like 50% ethnography and 50% the application of design principles, like the crits, like visualizing your ideas, like prototyping. It's all about the build. And a big part of that we borrow from design education is the role and the value of the critique, which is your ability to stand back from your work and take the feedback so that you can build on it. I've for 16 years, and in that time I taught business students, design students, engineering students. Business students were the absolute worst at taking feedback.
because whenever you would have a session for feedback on their work, they would start to be really different. It's not the point of feedback, right? The whole point is to see how I can grow and incorporate elements of your perspective into my work, because it's still a work in progress, right? So just 5 minutes, you know, replicate however you like this, what's called the golden circle. What is your why? What's your purpose? How do you accomplish your purpose? What is your thingamajig? My why is to change life and to optimize creativity in the way we work. How do I do that? I use design thinking and my background in anthropology, and I work with clients of all sorts, from all different types of sectors. What do? I am a right, so that's how I would back down from start with why. So how would you interpret it? And you don't have to have the final solid answer. Again, maybe I'm hoping you guys will want to continue to play around with these frameworks later. So just take 5 minutes. What's your why? Please begin. Hey, guys. I'd like you guys to make a huddle of maybe like 4 people at the most, just where you're seated. And you're gonna give each other feedback on what you've created. And I'd like here, so there's a way to give feedback, right? It's always nice to start with the positive, right? With the person shares out really quickly what they've created, how they've interpreted these questions. What do you like about what you see? What do you wish you understood more? What do you wish they explored more? What do you wish there was more of, less of? And finally, to really even more expansively, what are your what ifs to them? So what if, instead of only aiming to try to Portugal this summer, you figured out how to also tag on a trip to Spain, and then you incorporate that into some kind of research project for Professor blah, blah, blah. I don't know. So they get them to expand it even further. So let's just take like 8 to 10 minutes on you sharing in a small group where you're seated, what you came up with, and giving each other feedback, writing questions.
Okay, go for it. Guys, well done. Well done. Anyone want to make a comment, a reflection about what it was like to have to be able to explain your visual concepts, and then what it was like to get the feedback? Anyone want to share globally? What did it feel like? Supported, awkward, helpful. Yes.
I found I really couldn't critique my peers because I just like only had appreciation, and like I feel like we're critiquing their story, their life, you know. So.
Okay, that's fair. And again, think of it. The word critique does have a harsh connotation. Think of it more as just a supportive build. That was really the purpose, but I get you. I hear you. Thank you. Anyone else? Where's your hand? Thank you. Yeah.
It feels like very validating when someone that like you really like, and they're like, "Oh, that looks so cool! Like, good for you." Or like they like it too, and then you really connect.
It's affirming. It's encouraging. And I hope also you saw the value of the visualization tool, of being able to talk, through something through the visuals. I'm also hoping that because you were asked to visualize your ideas about who are you, where you think you're headed, and how might you get there, you might find that throughout the weekend and the months to come, that it'll be easier for your recall just by having the visual doodles versus if you wrote an outline, for example. Okay, so let's share. I would love it if like three of you, just in the remaining like 9 minutes that we have, would come up and share either your start with why or your doodle examples. And the way we're gonna do that is I'm gonna use photo booth on my laptop, take a picture, you're gonna come up here, you're gonna take a quick picture, it's gonna be projected up here, and then you get like 30 seconds to just explain your interpretation. Any takers? Yay! Come on up. Thank you. Come on up. Share a little bit about what we see up there.
All right. So, oh, okay. On the left top is my hoodie.
Sorry.
I wear it all the time. If you don't know me, it's also orange. And where the hood is, I drew like a little theater face, you know, with the like happy comedy and the tragic, dramatic side, because I'm a drama major. And then next to that, I got a little game controller because I like to play games. And then a pencil because I like to write stuff. And a half, my version of what a half Korean, half American fat flag would look like. And I thought about my religion, and then I thought too hard, and then I got confused and made a question mark. So that's who I am. And then what I want to do, there's like a little stage there and there's two people. I think I would like to be one of those two people. or, you know, there's, it's a little abstract here, but it's like a silhouette producing sound waves, as in a voice being received by a microphone, which is then being put onto a little animated character. Yeah, because I want to do like voice acting. I think that's cool. Or there's like a little script thing, because I thought I might try playwriting or something like that. And then how I might get there, there's someone doing an audition. I'm probably waiting for that audition. You know, that's someone else who's better at the moment. And then, or, you know, I could practice writing or, you know, talk to people and work together with people to get where I want to go. That's it.
Thank you so much. Anybody else? Come on. Come on up. Thank you.
Of, you can't see it in the picture, but I have a flag of China, also the Black Power Fist, and also an arrowhead necklace that I have from my tribe. It is a reflection of how my identities are intersectional within themselves, And also, it is me also surrounded by this self-love that's kind of small, but it's growing. And on the top, there's a little sprout because, in general, I am still growing as a person. So I decided to, like, that's a really big and important part of things, like, who I am. Even though it's not visible to everyone, I'm still, and everyone here is, like, achieving something that we're working towards. For where do I want to go, I want to go back to both, or all three, I guess, places where my identities have been displaced. So I want to go to China, like, very tangibly this summer to, like, learn a language that was taken from me. I want to learn Chinese, Mandarin, and Cantonese because my mom never taught me because she thought it was un-American. I want to also go to where my family was rightfully supposed to be before I moved to Oklahoma. So I want to go to, like, opposite of where I live in Northeast Florida to, like, Northwest, where my family is Seminole, and going to the reservation that probably maybe exists, but I wouldn't know because it's just not taught to me. And in the end, it says, like, Cape of Good Hope, and it trails off into a river from the marshlands that I live. I also want to go to ambiguously Africa because I don't know anything about my Black identity besides being from somewhere in the West Africa before being brought and sold to America. And how might I get there? Very physically, taking a plane to go to these places, but also by raising my hand when I know that something that is a part of me is important and should be shared in class, for example, or knowing that my story and narrative is also important, or by taking physical action, by voting, it's 2018, midterm elections, that stuff is important. Like reminding myself that my voice and what I'm experiencing is important and it matters. And by doing that, I have to be able to speak up in various ways. And that means by being here, talking to you guys, being like, hey, I exist, but also telling the government, hey, I exist, listen to what I have to say. And then it leads off into the last thing is, again, reminding ourselves that I'm important and that I should love myself, and it's a process, but also it's an important process that I need to go through, especially in trying times like now.
Awesome!
Thank you to the two individuals who were brave enough to share their stories. Isn't it cool how each of us can interpret the same question in such a wide range of ways? I hope that you'll consider dating your work, saving it, maybe framing it, and be interesting to see how you look upon it 2 years from now on that great day in May when you will be graduating from Vassar. So, guys, we have reached our time. Thank you so much for your open-mindedness, for being engaged. Thank you, everybody. See you around this weekend. Thank you.